الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين ربي اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي ربي زدني علما ربي زدني علما ربي زدني علما آمين يا رب العالمين أما بعد فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Welcome to a yet another exciting course from Team CIFIA. This course content has been created under the guidance of Shaykh Mir Asadullah Qadri, and I am a member of Team CIFIA, going to be your trainer today. Together, you and I will go into this exciting journey of learning about this important concept of Sahih Iman. So, welcome aboard. Shaykh Bahauddin Naqshband radiyallahu ta'ala anhu. This course content is divided into the following lectures. Introduction. Khwaja Muhammad Bahauddin Shah Naqshband radiyallahu ta'ala anhu is a bright star on the sky of Wilaya. He uplifted the hearts of millions from the darkness to the light of guidance and helped them soar in the sky. His greatness is undisputed. Sufi-i-Karam stand at his door with their hands folded, receiving his blessings with utmost humiliation. He is indeed the ocean of knowledge that has no shore. Khwaja Bahauddin Naqshband radiyallahu ta'ala anhu is my grand sheikh in Naqshbandi order. A brief account of the life of Khwaja Bahauddin Naqshband radiyallahu ta'ala anhu is provided in this course. Blessed birth. Khwaja Bahauddin Naqshband radiyallahu ta'ala anhu was born in 1718 AD in a rural area called Khasr-e-Hinduwan, which was later renamed as Khasr-e-Arifan, located near Bukhara, Uzbekistan. He was a direct descendant of Khalifat Rasulullah Amirul Mu'mineen Hadrat Ali ibn Abi Talib radiyallahu ta'ala anhu from father's side. It is reported that his birth was prophesied by Sheikh Muhammad Baba As-Samasi radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, who was a famous sheikh and Islamic jurist in Bukhara. Once, Sheikh As-Samasi radiallahu ta'ala anhu was passing through Khasr-ul-Arifan village. He smelled a fragrance emanating in the air. He turned towards his muridin and said, "I smell the fragrance of a great sheikh of Ihsan who will be born here." Whenever he passed through the village, he felt the same smell. One day, when he was passing through the village, he found the fragrance was very strong. He turned towards his muridin and said, "It looks like that Sheikh is already born." 3 days later, grandfather of Khwaja Naqshband radiyallahu ta'ala anhu took the newborn to Sheikh As-Samasi radiyallahu ta'ala anhu for his blessing. When the Sheikh looked at the child, he told his muridin, "This is the child about whom I had been telling you all along." He was very happy to see the child and declared, "This is my son and murid. He will be one of the greatest shuyukh. Allah will shower heavenly knowledge upon him that will be engraved upon his heart, and his silsila will be named after this engraving." Khwaja Naqshband radiyallahu ta'ala anhu used to say, "It is Allah's special beneficence on me that I was honored as son and murid by Sheikh As-Samasi radiyallahu ta'ala anhu right after my birth." Early life. Khwaja Naqshband radiyallahu ta'ala anhu completed his religious education and studied all Sharia sciences by the time he was 18 years old. Probably, he had memorized the whole Quran during this time. After completion of his education, he went back to Sheikh As-Samasi radiallahu ta'ala anhu again. He has described his meeting with the Sheikh as follows. "I was 18 years old when I went to meet Sheikh As-Samasi radiallahu ta'ala anhu. I reached his place and got the honor of meeting him. I stayed with him the whole day, and by his blessings, I found a great change in me. I went to sleep in his khanqah. I woke up towards the end of the night, performed ablution, wudu, and entered the mosque. I prayed 2 rakah and went into a long prostration. I supplicated and implored in front of Allah for his mercy and guidance. Later, Sheikh arrived in the mosque for Salatul Fajr, and after the prayer, he turned towards me and taught me how to supplicate in front of Allah. After that, the dining sheet was spread. And when everyone ate, he gave me a loaf of bread. I hesitated to take it as the bread was meant to be eaten by the people present. He told me, "Take, it will be of use to you." I kept the bread. After a while, Shaykh came out of the mosque, mounted on a donkey, and started going in a certain direction. I followed him walking behind his donkey. I tried to walk in complete attention towards Allah. However, whenever my attention was diverted on other things, Shaykh will turn towards me and advise me to guard my thoughts. I was surprised to see that Shaykh knew what I was thinking in my mind. After a few hours, we stopped at a place and Shaykh entered a house that belonged to one of his murideen. When his murid saw the Shaykh, he was a little disturbed. The Shaykh asked him the reason. He said he has nothing to serve the Shaykh at home except milk. Shaykh turned towards me and said, "Take out the loaf of bread I gave you. Now it will be useful for us." In his company, this kind of events were routine and plenty that resulted in increase of my love and respect for my Shaykh. Teachers and Shuyukh. Khwaja Naqshband radiallahu ta'ala anhu remained in the company of Shaykh As-Samasi radiallahu ta'ala anhu for a few years. The picture shows maqam of Shaykh Muhammad Baba As-Samasi radiallahu ta'ala anhu. After the death of Shaykh As-Samasi radiallahu ta'ala anhu, Khwaja Naqshband radiallahu ta'ala anhu moved to Samarkand. After some time, he went to Bukhara. In both the places, he spent time in the company of famous shuyukh. In Bukhara, he got married. When he was in Bukhara, he was given khilafah by Shaykh Azizan Ali Ramitani radiallahu ta'ala anhu, who was his grand shaykh in Naqshbandi silsila, died a few years earlier. A few months later, Shaykh Sayyid Amir Kulal, the khalifa and successor of Shaykh As-Samasi radiallahu ta'ala anhu, met Khwaja Naqshband and informed him that at the time of death, Shaykh As-Samasi radiallahu ta'ala anhu had advised him to take care of him. The picture shows the dome of Shaykh Sayyid Amir Kulal radiallahu ta'ala anhu. Khwaja Naqshband radiallahu ta'ala anhu spent a few years in the company of Shaykh Amir Kulal radiallahu ta'ala anhu. Later, Shaykh Kulal gave him khilafah by handing over the cloak of Shaykh Ramitani radiallahu ta'ala anhu, which was given to him by his Shaykh As-Samasi radiallahu ta'ala anhu as a relic of the silsila. Khwaja Naqshband radiallahu ta'ala anhu mentioned several incidents that occurred when he was in the company of Shaykh Kulal radiallahu ta'ala anhu. One of the incidents is as follows. When I was in the company of Shaykh Kulal radiallahu ta'ala anhu, I was often overwhelmed with jazb, nearness to Allah, and used to wander around secluded places. One night, I was wandering in that state and my feet were bleeding as I was walking barefooted in a thorny jungle. It was pitch dark and snow was falling intermittently. I was freezing as I had no warm clothes to cover my body. In such a state, I do not know how I reached Shaykh Kulal radiallahu ta'ala anhu's house. When I reached there, Shaykh was sitting with his students. When I knocked the door, he came out and saw me in that state. He went inside and asked his students to throw me out on the road. They all forcefully lifted me and threw me on the road. I was shocked and felt humiliated and could not understand why I was treated in this way. My nafs raised its head from within and asked me to leave the Shaykh for this kind of unwarranted harsh treatment in a dark freezing night. However, Allah's guidance came to me. I said to my nafs, "I will bear this, but will not leave the company of the Shaykh." I went back to Shaykh's door, placed my head on his doorstep and closed my eyes. I remained silent and did not knock his door again. I do not know how long I sat in that condition. Just before dawn, Shaykh came out of the house and found me on his doorstep. He lifted my head and realized I was almost unconscious. He took me inside, provided me warm clothes, gave me food, and removed all thorns from my feet, from his hands, one by one. Tears were rolling down from his eyes. He cleansed all my wounds and hugged me emotionally. He said, "My son, you will go a long way on this path, and many will benefit from your company in future." Khwaja Naqshband radiallahu ta'ala anhu used to relate the above episode and used to say, "I am always in the look for the seeker who would place his head on my doorstep in humility, but often find most of them come to me in the pursuit of becoming sheikhs, not murids. Among my seekers, I find hardly any sincere murid. A murid has to leave his ego, nafs, and become like a dead body in the hands of a shaykh. This is the only way to cleanse oneself from the impurities. Khwaja Naqshband described another incident in the company of Shaykh Kulal radiallahu ta'ala anhu as follows. I was in Bukhara and Shaykh Kulal radiallahu ta'ala anhu was in Nasaf, and a yearning occurred to me to meet the Shaykh. I headed towards Nasaf and reached his house. When I knocked his door, Shaykh came out and saw me. He said, my son, you have come at a right time. We are in need of logs for our kitchen that have been cut in the nearby jungle. Can you bring those logs for us? When I reached the place, I realized the trees that were cut had thorns, and Shaykh had instructed the woodcutter not to remove the thorns from the logs. I made bundles of those logs and carried them on my back one by one. The thorns pricked all over my back, but I obeyed the Shaykh happily. Khwaja Naqshband radiallahu ta'ala anhu related the above incident in one of his writings later and wrote, in pursuit of haqq, the harshness of thorns did not trouble me. They seemed like soft silky buttons, providing the joy I never felt before. Alright, this concludes the lecture. Take a breather and we will get back in a minute to continue this journey of learning. Khwaja Naqshband radiallahu ta'ala anhu received training from Khwaja Abdul Khaliq Kujdawani radiallahu ta'ala anhu as well, who was Grand Sheikh of his silsila, died 200 years ago in 575 AH, 1180 AD. He mentioned about this training as follows. One night, I visited the dargah of Sheikh Ahmad Al-Kashgari rahmatullah alayh. I found two men waiting for me there. I had not seen them before. They had a horse with them. They made me sit on the horse and tied two swords on my two sides. They directed the horse to the dargah of Sheikh Mazdakhin rahmatullah alayh. When I entered his maqam, I had a vision. I saw the wall of his dargah facing the Kaaba came down crashing. Behind the wall, I saw a heavy-built Sheikh seated on a huge throne. Around him were seated Sheikh As-Samasi radiallahu ta'ala anhu, Sheikh Kulal radiallahu ta'ala anhu, and other grand shuyukh of our silsila. There were some more people around. I was told that the person sitting on the throne was Sheikh Abdul Khaliq Kujadawani radiallahu ta'ala anhu, who had looked after me all along. I was informed that I was under his spiritual training right from the beginning. Sheikh Kujadawani radiallahu ta'ala anhu then turned towards me and advised me a few things to remember. The next day, I went to Sheikh Kulal radiallahu ta'ala anhu and described him my vision. Sheikh said he is aware of it. He took me inside a room and taught me zikr-e-kafi, silent zikr, that was to be carried out day and night. He said Sheikh Kujadawani radiallahu ta'ala anhu asked him to teach me zikr-e-kafi, silent zikr. The picture shows the maqam of Sheikh Abdul Khaliq al-Kujadawani radiallahu ta'ala anhu in Bukhara, Uzbekistan. The students of Sheikh Amir Kulal radiallahu ta'ala anhu used to do zikr aloud when they were together and silent zikr when they were alone. When Khwaja Naqshband radiallahu ta'ala anhu received instruction to do zikr silently, he stopped loud zikr completely and focused on silent zikr the rest of his life. This became the distinguishing feature of the Naqshbandi silsila. Sheikh Amir Kulal radiallahu ta'ala anhu died in 1363 when Khwaja Naqshband radiallahu ta'ala anhu was 35 years old. After his death, he was in the company of Shaykh Arifuddin Karani radiallahu ta'ala anhu for some time. Later, he spent some time in the company of Shaykh Khutum. Khwaja Naqshband radiallahu ta'ala anhu spent 7 years in the company of Shaykh Khalil Girani radiallahu ta'ala anhu. He described how he met Shaykh Khalil Girani radiallahu ta'ala anhu and how he remained in his company for the following 7 years. I saw Shaykh Al-Hakim Ata radiallahu ta'ala anhu, the great Shaykh of Turkey, in a dream, advising another Shaykh to take care of me. When I woke up, the Shaykh's image was in my mind. I kept looking for that Shaykh until I found him in Bukhara one day. I immediately recognized him. I was informed that his name was Shaykh Khalil Girhani radiallahu ta'ala anhu. It so happened that I could not say anything to him, and then he disappeared in the crowd. I came home disheartened and worried. After Maghrib, I heard a knock on my door. A person was standing on my door. He said, Shaykh Khalil radiallahu ta'ala anhu wants to see you. I promptly took a visiting gift and went to see him. I sat in the audience and wanted to tell him about my dream. But before I could do that, the Shaykh told me in Turkish, I know what you saw. There is no need to repeat it. When I heard him saying this, I was amazed. I remained in his company for the following 7 years and learned many traits of the path. Khwaja Bahauddin Naqshband radiallahu ta'ala anhu described his meeting with Ghaus al-Azam radiallahu ta'ala anhu as follows. Once, I was traveling in a desert. On my way, I met Khizr alayhi salam. Hadrat Khizr alayhi salam took me to the audience of Ghaus al-Azam radiallahu ta'ala anhu. At that time, I was not famous and was not known as Naqshband. Ghaus al-Azam radiallahu ta'ala anhu placed his hand on my chest and said, O the holder of the adornment of the worlds, hold my adornment so that they can call you Naqshband. After that incident, I became famous as Naqshband. It is reported that Khwaja Naqshband radiallahu ta'ala anhu wrote the following in praise of Ghaus al-Azam radiallahu ta'ala anhu after that meeting. The king of this world and the hereafter is Shah Abdul Qadir radiallahu ta'ala anhu. The head of the children of Adam is Shah Abdul Qadir radiallahu ta'ala anhu. Sun, moon, heavens, the throne, and the pen, they all get their light from the heart of Shah Abdul Qadir radiallahu ta'ala anhu. When some muridi asked Khwaja Bahauddin Naqshband radiallahu ta'ala anhu what he has to say about the declaration of Ghaus al-Azam radiallahu ta'ala anhu, my foot is on the neck of all awliya Allah, he said, may his foot be on my eyes and my vision. Many great shuyukh were assigned to help Khwaja Naqshband radiallahu ta'ala anhu in his spiritual journey. He once described that he spent long years in the company of Hadrat Uwais al-Qarani radiallahu ta'ala anhu, who taught him how to shed internal and external bonds. Similarly, he learned complete attribute effacement in the company of Shaykh Muhammad ibn Ali al-Hakim al-Tirmidhi radiallahu ta'ala anhu. Madrasa Naqshbandiya Khasr al-Arifan. Khwaja Naqshband radiallahu ta'ala anhu stayed in Merv and Bukhara for long years. Later, he returned back to his native place, Khasr al-Arifan. Towards the end of his life, he had become very popular. Thousands of visitors from far and wide used to visit him for advice. He established a big Arabic madrasa and a mosque in Khasr al-Arifan. The madrasa had become very popular during his lifetime. Thousands of people received education in this school. It is reported that at a time, over 5,000 people were accommodated in the school complex. The school survived 700 years and was renovated after the fall of Soviet Union in 1990s.
All right, this concludes the lecture. Take a breather and we will get back in a minute to continue this journey of learning.
personal traits. Khwaja Naqshband radiallahu ta'ala anhu was an exemplary model of conduct for his students and murideen.
A few aspects of his personal traits are described below for the benefit of our students.
First, Khwaja Bahauddin radiallahu ta'ala anhu used to fast most of the days in the month. At the time of breaking the fast, he used to eat the barley he had grown himself. He would harvest it, grind it, make the dough, knead it, and bake it himself. He used to share his food with the visiting scholars, seekers, and the needy. He used to serve food to the people by his own hands. Once he was invited to a town where one of his students had prepared food. When the dining sheet was spread, he refused to eat and said, "My son, when you prepared this food, from the time you kneaded the dough, cooked and served, you were in the state of anger. Your food is mixed with your anger. If we eat it, Satan will find a way to enter our bodies and insinuate it with his evil thoughts." Second, Shaykh Muhammad ibn Mahmud al-Hafizi, also known as Muhammad Parsa, who was Shaykh's Khalifa, reported an incident as follows. When Shaykh Muhammad Shamsuddin al-Jazari visited Samarkand, Mirza Alek Beg was our king. Some jealous scholars complained to the king that I was narrating a hadith whose chain of transmission were unknown. The king ordered me to appear before him. I informed the king about this happening. The Shaykh said, "Do not worry, I will accompany you." When we reached there, we found Shaykh Husamuddin An-Nahawi, the Mufti of Bukhara, sitting in the king's court hall along with many other scholars. Shaykh Shamsuddin Al-Jazari was also present. Shaykh Hasamuddin asked me about the chain of narrators of a hadith which I had described in front of people earlier. When I gave him the chain, they claimed it is incorrect. They asked me the chain of another hadith. When I described the chain, they claimed it was incorrect. Shaykh interfered at that moment, as he knew that whatever I say, they will reject it. He asked me to tell Shaykh Husamuddin as follows. "You are the Shaykh and the Mufti. What do you say about such and such narrator?" Shaykh Husamuddin said, "We accept him as trustworthy, as his lineage is such that all scholars accept, and there is no argument on that matter." Then Shaykh told me to tell Shaykh Husamuddin that the hadith scholar you are accepting as authentic has written a book of a hadith. It is available in your home. It contains 500 pages and its color is such and such. And the ahadith you have rejected are written by him on such and such page numbers in that book. Shaykh Husamuddin did not remember that book. He refused to have such a book at his home. To find out the truth, the king sent a person to his house to find that book. We all waited for the person to return. The person came to his house and found that book. The book was brought to the court hall. When they looked, the ahadith were found on the pages as described by the Shaykh. Third, one of the murids of Khwaja Naqshband radiallahu ta'ala anhu, named Muhammad Zahid, described an incident in the company of the Shaykh as follows. A few months had passed since I became murid. Once I was sitting in front of the Shaykh. It was spring season. I felt a craving to eat watermelon. When this thought occurred in my mind repeatedly, Shaykh looked at me and said, "Muhammad Zahid, go to the stream near our house and bring us what you see and we will eat it." I went to the rivulet and found a watermelon flowing on the surface of the stream close by its bank. I was able to catch the watermelon from my hand. The watermelon was very fresh. I brought it to the Shaykh. The fruit was cut into pieces and all in attendance were served with it. Fourth, Khwaja Bahauddin radiallahu ta'ala anhu described three ways to achieve the knowledge of truth. First, contemplation, muraqabah. Second, vision, mushahada. And third, reckoning, muhasaba. Explaining the terms, he said, in the state of contemplation, the seeker forgets about the entire creation and remembers only the Creator. In the state of vision, inspirations from the unseen come to the heart of the seeker, accompanied by two states, A, contraction, and B, expansion. In contraction, the vision is held at the majesty of Almighty. In expansion, the seeker sees the beauty of his tajalliyat. In the state of reckoning, the seeker evaluates every second that has passed, was in the presence of Allah, or in the presence of the world. The general rule is, the seeker must reject Satan's evil whispering and anima, nafs, insinuations. It is important to reject them before they reach him. At least he should reject them after they reach him. If he allows them to reach and control him, it is very difficult for him to take them out of his heart. Death. Khwaja Naqshband radiyallahu ta'ala anhu died on Monday, 3rd Rabia 1, 791 AH, March 3rd, 1389 AD. As per his instructions, he was buried in the garden within his school complex. The successive rulers of Bukhara expanded the complex and a massive mausoleum was constructed at his maqam. Surrounded by ever-expanding complexes and buildings, his mausoleum in Bukhara, Uzbekistan, is visited by thousands of Muslims from all over the world. Naqshbandi works. After the death of Khwaja Naqshband radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, successive scholars have written books about his deeds and sayings. These include, first, Aurad al-Naqshbandiya, second, Tanbih al-Ghafili, third, Maslakul Anwar, fourth, Hidayatul Salikin wa Tawfatul Talibin, etc. Biographical accounts. Biographical accounts of Khwaja Naqshband radiyallahu ta'ala anhu were written and published after his death by many Naqshbandi scholars. These include, first, Aurat Bahauddin by Masood al-Bukhari and Sharif al-Jarjani. This book contains his life's work and fatawa. Second, Risala Khudsiya by Sheikh Muhammad Parsa, died in Medina in 822 AH, 1419 AD. Third, Al-Bahja al-Sanayya by Khani. Fourth, Anis al-Talibin by Salahuddin Muhammad Bukhari. Spiritual chain. Spiritual golden chain, Shajara-e-Tariqa, of Khwaja Bahauddin Naqshband radiyallahu ta'ala anhu is as follows. First, Ahmad Mushtaba Muhammad Mustafa sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Second, Amir al-Mu'mineen Abu Bakr Siddiq radiyallahu ta'ala anhu. Third, Hadrat Salman Farsi radiyallahu ta'ala anhu. Fourth, Hadrat Qasim ibn Muhammad ibn Abu Bakr radiyallahu ta'ala anhu. Fifth, Hadrat Imam Jafar Sadiq radiyallahu ta'ala anhu. Sixth, Hadrat Bayazid Bastami radiyallahu ta'ala anhu. Seventh, Hadrat Abul Hasan Al-Kharakhani radiyallahu ta'ala anhu. Eighth, Hadrat Abul Qasim Gurgani radiyallahu ta'ala anhu. Ninth, Hadrat Abu Ali Farmadi radiyallahu ta'ala anhu. Tenth, Hadrat Abu Yaqub Yusuf Hamadani radiyallahu ta'ala anhu. 11th, Hadrat Abdul Khaliq Gujdawani radiyallahu ta'ala anhu. 12th, Hadrat Arif Riyogari radiyallahu ta'ala anhu. 13th, Hadrat Mahmud Anjir Faghnabi radiyallahu ta'ala anhu. 14th, Hadrat Khwaja Azizan Ali Ramitani radiyallahu ta'ala anhu. 15th, Hadrat Khwaja Muhammad As-Samasi radiyallahu ta'ala anhu. 16th, Hadrat Khwaja Amir Kulal radiyallahu ta'ala anhu. 17th, Hadrat Khwaja Bahauddin Naqshband radiyallahu ta'ala anhu. Successors. Some well-known shuyukh who continued Khwaja Naqshband radiyallahu ta'ala anhu's legacy after his death are as follows. First, Sheikh Alauddin Bukhari al-Attar rahmatullah alayhi, died 802 AH, 1393 AD, Khalifa and son-in-law of Khwaja Bahauddin Naqshband radiyallahu ta'ala anhu. Second, Sheikh Muhammad ibn Mahmud al-Hafizi rahmatullah alayhi, also known as Muhammad Parsa, died in 822 AH, 1419 AD. He was a prolific writer and author of Risala Qudsiya. He is the founder of many traditions of Naqshbandi order. Third, Sheikh Yaqub Al-Karki rahmatullah alayhi of Ghazni died in 851 AH, 1447 AD. He was responsible for the expansion of Naqshbandi order in Central Asia. Fourth, Sheikh Ahmad Faruqi Sirhindi rahmatullah alayhi. He was an Indian scholar and jurist, lived during 1564 to 1624 in India. He is described as a reviver of the second millennium for his struggle in opposing Deen-e-Ilahi, a cocktail of religions founded by Mughal Emperor Akbar in India. His sheikh was Khwaja Baqi Billah rahmatullah alayh, who was the originator and pioneer of Naqshbandi order in Indian subcontinent. Teaching. Khwaja Bahauddin Naqshband radiyallahu ta'ala anhu is among Awliya-e-Kubar. He taught people Islamic Tawheed, the tenets of Islam, love of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, his Ahle Bayt-e Athar, dignitaries of Islam and Awliya Allah. He followed Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam in every aspect of his life. His services in spreading Islam in Central Asia are unparalleled.
All right, this concludes the lecture. Before you go, you can find more information of many other Islamic topics like the one we discussed in this course at sahihiman.com/books. Hundreds of books available explaining multiple Islamic topics up for grabs for free. So do check it out. Thank you for signing up for this course. We hope you had a great time learning about this important topic as we had preparing this course for you. See you again for another exciting learning experience at the Correct Islamic Faith International Academy. Until then, it's goodbye from us at Team CIFIA.